My wife told me one time she felt sorry for me getting up early in the morning and having to come into work. And I said, hold on a minute. I come to work and play. This is kind of the way the field of geology is. Every single sample that you look at is different. It has a different story to tell. It has different characteristics. There's always something new. I come to work and play every day. So we need to unbox the samples and get them prepared for cutting. Basically, what we're looking at are rock samples that have been collected in the Grand Canyon and begin doing the technical rock analysis on those samples. This involves, first of all, thin section manufacture. And so this is taking rock materials down to the thickness that you can actually see through them. And this sample is very carefully labeled with an arrow pointing up with top and an identifier, which in this case is, there it is, CCF1, which is Carbon Canyon Fold Number 1. But initially we need to cut these rocks, dry them, and get them prepped for thin section analysis. All right, this will be noisy. Okay, right now I'm going to put an orientation mark on this rock to show what end is up. That will be crucial to determine how the bedding structure is affected by how the rock materials originally were laid down. The sample is now ready for drying in preparation for liquid epoxy impregnation in this sample. Many professional geologists aren't aware of how to do this process. There are only a handful of people, perhaps in the entire world, who know how to do this kind of thing, at least to do it well. Literally a handful of people. Okay, the epoxy is used for stabilizing the sample, and if you fill up all the pore space with epoxy, you wind up, first of all, being able to identify where the porosity is, and secondly, you stabilize all the very fine material found in the pore spaces. So this is a high-pressure cell which we use to inject the liquid epoxy into the pore spaces in the sample. In the morning, we can retrieve it. The epoxy will be solidified, and then we can handle that piece of rock safely all through the rest of the next part of the process. It is important that we continue this work and that it succeed, because I believe there's a whole side of scientific investigation that has been largely ignored. And one of the aims that I have is to chase that particular pathway and look at data that may be not necessarily mainstream, but is very, very interesting and is significant. And so that's my endeavor in working with Andrew, for example, is to see what the data says and where there's supporting evidence to make sure that that's well documented. Okay, what we're doing now is taking the epoxy away from the bottom surface, and we're exposing the rock that's been impregnated with blue dyed epoxy. And so what that does is allow us to get a nice, flat, optically planar surface. And in this case, it's extremely important. We're not mistaking scratches for fractures. So we don't want to leave scratches in the rock surface. We want to make sure that all the scratches are out so that the fractures can be easily identified. Okay, so we're going to move on to the staining process, and then it will be ready for mounting to glass. We don't want to induce any kind of fracturing into the sample. And so mounting this to glass using the cyanoacrylate glue, crazy glue, ensures that we have a good, stable surface with which to work. Imagine trying to work with a single piece of hair and trying to grind it without affecting the character of the hair. We want to make sure that we don't disturb the mineralogy of the sample as we go through the cutting and grinding processes. This slide we will now take to our grinding laps, where we'll thin it down to about 30 micron thickness. And this is kind of where the art comes into play. Do just a quick look in the microscope here, and it looks like we're pretty well at 30 microns thickness all the way across the entire thin section. We have the grains seen as being very clear. The material showing up as blue is empty space. And in cross-polarized light, if showing either as a gray or as a pale straw yellow. And that tells us that we're right on the 30 micron thickness. Back in the day when we were really busy, we would do anywhere between 80 to 100 of these types of samples a day. Personally, I've probably done in the order of about 20,000, I guess. Now we'll take the slide and look at it under the good petrographic microscope, which is a special kind of microscope made for analyzing geological thin sections.